an anniversary.
So what did you get us?
Gold earrings?
A gold necklace?
Or just a good old-fashioned gold bar?
We're not picky.
Thanks for 50 fabulous years of radio at Nassau Community College.
The voice of Nassau Community College.
This is the award-winning 90.3 WHPC HD Garden City.
Listen on your smart speaker.
Play WHPC.
And available on Odyssey, TuneIn, iHeart, and on the WHPC app.
90.3 WHPC.
WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College, and also voted best on Long Island, best radio station category. Thank you for everyone who voted for us. We truly are happy and proud of the distinction. Hello, brother. How are we doing today?
Wrestling with this microphone, brother. But otherwise, very good.
Good to hear. I am Rob Leonard. Joining me, of course, is my brother and co-host and award-winning sports writer, Tim Leonard. Hello, brother.
Good morning.
Let me just make sure you're on the right mic here. Just say hello, brother.
Good morning.
Hello, brother.
Good morning again.
Oh, there you go. Okay. Woohoo! You're still on mic two. Okay.
Hey, you told me mic two.
That sounds a lot better. Well, that other mic sounds a little thin. I don't know what's wrong with it. We'll just see. But that sounds a little better, which isn't bad. It's not like we couldn't hear you on the other mic because you have a big booming voice.
Yes.
So anyway, brother, how are things going? How are things in
Tottenham? What a day, brother. What a day. First of all, happy Martin Luther King Day.
Well, you really shouldn't say that. You should be like, well, we're here to celebrate.
We're here to honor the man and the legacy.
Yeah, we should say that, you know, everyone talks about the I Have a Dream speech in 62. Was it 63? I forget which one. 63, I think it was. Whenever it was.
It was a long time ago.
But he was moving toward other things towards the end. People forget that about him. He was moving toward fair housing, and of course, he was supporting the reason he was in Memphis.
I support fair housing.
The reason he was in Memphis partly was to support a striking garbage man. So, you know, people forget that. Everyone thinks, oh, you know, it's the one speech in.
No, there was a lot of stuff going on.
In D.C.
I'm not going to get overly political, but it sounds like somebody who I admire and respect and voted for. So
Who's that? That's
a good thing. Just going with the striking Gordon. Who was the only politician who walks the picket lines?
I don't know.
Bernie Sanders.
Okay. We should say March on Washington just to make sure because I don't want anyone to think I don't know anything. August 28th, 1963. I was 8 days old at that time.
Congratulations. So you were there.
In spirit, I was, yes. So anyway, it's more remembrances and stuff like that. We shouldn't say happy Martin Luther King Day. It's just a weird phrase.
Yes. You know. Also, I will say happy 100th birthday to Betty White.
She would have been 100.
Who almost made it.
Almost made it. She did.
Very sad.
Yeah, she did make it. Think about all those days.
They're still doing that movie stuff with her, aren't they? I mean, that was supposed to be the celebration.
Well,
was that they made a documentary film about her life,
right?
That was supposed to be shown one day only. Today was the day.
Yeah,
in
still
different
doing
theaters
it
around the country.
And a lot of people, what they've been doing instead, to remember her, they've been adopting animals.
Well, no, donating to rescues and shelters.
Or donating in her name. So
yes, so do that.
If you want to do that.
You have $2 jangling around your pocket.
Can't hurt.
Help out some dogs. Always a good idea.
I miss our Curly, the terror dog.
No.
Ask Mandersina about.
She was adorable.
I love her. Anyway, brother, I don't even know where to start. There's so much football yesterday because of the NFL playoffs.
Oh, playoffs everywhere, brother. Crazy stuff going on in the playoffs. Some expected results, some butt whoopings, and a crazy ending to the Cowboys 49ers game. Or I should say the 49ers Cowboys game, since the 49ers actually won the game.
Right. It's always happy when the Cowboys lose, let's be honest.
You know, I know some Cowboys fans were disappointed. Me personally, I'm very disappointed in what Dak Prescott, the Cowboys quarterback, had to say about the game, after the game.
Right.
For anybody who may not have watched the playoffs yesterday, may not have been planted in front of your television with you know, four bags of chips and a couple of six-packs, you know, because we're American. The Cowboys came back in the fourth quarter against the 49ers, who actually had been controlling the game pretty well. It was 23-7 going into the fourth quarter. Cowboys cut it to 23-17 and had the ball with, I want to say, about a minute and a half left, maybe a minute 20, and ran three plays, at all chunk plays, as the pundits like to say, and the commentators, chunk plays, which means they're getting at least 10 yards per play on this.
Right.
So they wound up going from the 20 to, I want to say, about the 50 or even the 49ers 40. It was they were moving the ball. So with about, I want to say, I think it was 14 seconds left in the game, the Cowboys called a play that I still have no clue what they were thinking. Because they have, it's 14 seconds, they don't have any timeouts left, and Dak Prescott goes on a quarterback draw. Which, effective play. Don't get me wrong. It's an effective play. But when you only have 14 seconds on the clock, it's a dumb play. Because now you're playing with time. And time, at that point in the game, is your enemy.
Yeah.
So, what happens? Prescott gains, I don't even know, 12 yards or whatever it was. He got to, like, the 20-something. And the plan was, for Dak, he slid, gets the ball down, and it was, the plan was, get the first down, spike the ball. You'll have a second or so, or two maybe, and you toss the ball into the end zone for the last play of the game and hope for the best. That was basically the best scenario for the Cowboys. So instead, what does Dak Prescott do? He slides, and instead of finding the umpire, because the umpire has to spot, he's the guy that spots the ball.
Right.
Every quarterback either should know this or does know this. And Dak Prescott, instead of finding the ball, just puts the ball down at the spot himself. Center lines up. Dak's right under him, puts his hands, you know, like right. He's ready to take the snap. Well, here comes the umpire on a dead sprint. He needs to touch the ball before anything can happen. Meanwhile, 4, 3, 2, and the umpire actually literally bumps into Prescott and the center because he's got to spot the ball.
Right.
He grabbed the ball. There was like three or four seconds left. He gets the ball, boom, puts it down. It took half a second. Ball gets snapped. One, boom, Dak throws it into the ground. Clock reads zero. The game is over. And you've never heard so much whining from Cowboys fans. Like, first of all, the umpire, I don't know how old this guy is, but most referees in the NFL are somewhere in the neighborhood of 50 to 60 years old.
Yeah.
They wanted this guy to be Usain Bolt. Oh, he was too slow. He's in his 50s. How fast do you expect him to be? Dead sprint this guy was on. I saw him coming into the picture. He's not a wide receiver. He's not running a 4.3 40. He is an older man who most of these refs are in decent shape. I give him credit.
They have to be.
I give them credit. But he has to. The rule is that he has to touch the ball. He has to spot the ball before a play can be snapped. Everything went as it should have. So what happens? I mean, first of all, referee came on and said, clock reads zero, the game is over. You know, it doesn't matter, because when Dak spiked the ball, by the time he spiked it, the clock, it said zero.
Right.
So that's, you know, I mean, as soon as the ball gets spiked, the clock is stopped. Well, we all saw it. The clock said zero. After the game, I was disgusted with Dak Prescott and the comments that he made in the press conference.
Let's not focus too much on this.
Well, I think we have to focus on this.
There's actual games to talk
about.
You know,
I'm going to touch on this because it was disgraceful.
Hurry up, because we've already wasted 10 minutes.
Well, that was you.
That wasn't me.
Dak, they asked him the fans at Dallas, of course, they're infuriated. They just lost another game. 11 consecutive postseason appearances. They have not gotten to the conference championship game. So the Cowboys, the fans should be used to failing in the playoffs. Instead, they're all upset. But they were throwing stuff on the field. There was debris being thrown, all kinds of garbage and whatever. Dak Prescott at first, and he was asked about that after the game, thought that the fans were throwing stuff at Cowboys players. He was very upset about that. Talked about how, you know, how they work hard and they every day of their lives and give everything to the sport, et cetera, et cetera. Then a reporter clarifies to Prescott that the fans appeared to be upset with the officials and were trying to throw garbage at the officiating crew. Dak Prescott says, and I quote, "Credit to them then." Yeah, credit to them. Credit to them. Are you kidding?
Okay.
Are you kidding? Dak
Prescott is not the smartest guy on the field.
Just horrible.
Yeah, well, there are better things to talk about than Dak Prescott. I mean, I don't care about the Cowboys too much, so it's I stopped caring about them a long time. When Jerry Jones took over the team,
You can't endorse behavior that is
I don't endorse
threatening
it. He's gonna get a fine. $25,000.
It might be more than that. I hope it's more than that. It should be more than that. It should be $100,000.
I don't think they'll go that far.
You can't endorse that kind of behavior.
So, anyway, let's start off with the NFL. Let's see. Where do we start? Well, we'll talk about the 49ers Cowboys. Well, I mean, we'll start there, really. I don't know. It was 23, 17.
What are you doing, bro?
I don't know. We just talked about it. Okay, we'll split them up.
Move to the – you know what? The biggest game of the weekend before the Cowboys and 49ers was Bills-Patriots.
Okay.
Hello, ass-whipping. And the Patriots on the receiving end of it. That was beautiful.
Yeah, well, yeah.
When the game started, brother, it was 7 degrees in Buffalo.
You gotta love that.
Seven.
You gotta love
my boy Bob Suda was there. He was all talking about all the layers and they that's what they do in Buffalo. They know how to stay warm.
Well,
I give him credit for that.
You wear double layers of gloves.
Triple. I believe you. 7 degrees. You got to be out there for 4 hours. He posted on Facebook. He says it was the first blue light slushy of the night. You know what that is, brother?
I have no
idea. That's when your Labatt blue ice freezes. So it's like it turns into slush.
Oh, okay.
So that's how cold it is. That your beer is turning into slush. It's like a beer slurpee.
Hey. That sounds like
that's
fun.
That's cold. Oh my God.
And it's always fun when the Patriots lose, and you know, the Patriots ain't what they used to be, let's be honest.
Not just lost, got crushed. It was beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. The Bills just kept scoring touchdowns. Josh Allen, 5 touchdown passes. Yes, Josh Allen. Thank you very much. Everybody loves Josh Allen today. Everybody outside of Boston.
Well,
my mook friend Croce was trying to spin it positive. He's like, oh, we got Mac Jones. We got a quarterback. We got a future. Croce, you got destroyed. You don't have a future when you lose a playoff game by 30 points.
No.
That's not a future I want.
And, of course, the Bills are the only team that play in New York State. So.
Exactly. It was a New York team beating a Boston team. Exactly. Good point, brother. So that was good. We liked that game. Then I'm not even going to go in order. I'm just going to go in my order. The Chiefs last night beat up on the Steelers, 42-21. Patrick Mahomes, another 5-touchdown performance.
Right.
You know, Patrick Mahomes, you expect it from, pretty much. The Steelers, the Steelers really didn't belong in the playoffs. That was not a playoff team. Big Ben, Ben Roethlisberger, the Steelers quarterback, basically willed them into the playoffs in the last couple of weeks of the season. They won games they shouldn't have won. It was like the football gods wanted Big Ben to have one last day. Because I'm pretty sure yesterday was his last game of his career. You know, he talked about how it was an honor to be a Steeler. You know, everything he said after the game tells me he's retiring.
He can do what, you know, a lot of other players have done as quarterbacks. When they led their team for all those years, they decide to go somewhere else.
He's not going to go somewhere else. Because the Steelers don't have a replacement for him, first of all.
Maybe he stays around another year.
I find that hard to believe. Because, first of all, he's making way too much money. He would have to take a massive pay cut. But, you know, you get to a point, bro. You get to an age where you just don't want to take the abuse anymore. And you know, quarterback is a position where you, if especially if you don't have a very good offensive line, you're gonna take a lot of hits. Nobody wants to do that, especially as you get older. I mean, Big Ben, he's got to be about 40 by now. So, you know, I mean, he's had a great career. He's a Hall of Fame guy. So, or a Hall of Fame player, I shouldn't say a Hall of Fame, not a Hall of Fame person necessarily.
He turns 40 on March 2nd.
Yeah, so he's almost 40. He's 2 months, or less than 2 months from 40. That's up there.
Started playing in 2004.
Exactly. He was in the same same draft class as Eli and Philip Rivers and Ben Roethlisberger. Those were the three main quarterbacks in that draft. So, you know, hey, good for Big Ben that he lasted this long, but he's done. The Steelers are – it's going to be a test next season for Mike Tomlin, because Mike Tomlin, the head coach, has never had a losing season. Next season he's going to test that, because I still don't think that this year's draft class, I don't think there is an impact quarterback in the class. And there are a lot of teams out there that need quarterbacks and are probably going to draft a quarterback in this year's draft and just keep their fingers crossed that these somebody is better than they've looked in college, or that they can coach one of these kids up and actually have them turn into something that resembles an NFL starting quarterback. Because I personally think that there are a lot of Daniel Jones types and Dwayne Haskins types. Remember that draft from 3 years ago?
Yep.
Which there was no quarterbacks in that draft. And teams that need quarterbacks have to draft them, and then they get stuck, and then it just sets your franchise back even more years, which is where the Giants are right now. Anyway, Bengals-Raiders. That was another game that came down to the last play of the game. Bengals were pretty reasonably in control, and the Raiders, much like the Cowboys, rallied in the fourth quarter. Derek Carr drove the Raiders down the field and just couldn't get the ball into the end zone on the last play of the game. The Raiders were knocking on the door. It was like they were inside the 10. So the game was there to either be tied or won. I mean, it was 26-19. That would have been, if they would have scored the touchdown, then I would have really liked to have seen, are they going to go for two, or are they just going to go for the overtime and you know, take a breath and regroup and see what it is.
You got to take the overtime on that.
Well, I mean, it would have been fun to see what the decision would have been. That's all I'm saying.
This is the first time the Bengals have made the playoffs in 30 years.
Yeah, 31 years. 1991. First playoff win for the Bengals since 1991.
Wow.
And the Bengals coach, this was a funny story. Bengals coach stopped off at a bar on his way home and just like picked a random bar, like some bar that he passes on his way home, and went into the bar and handed it was just fans. It was just like, okay, hey, game ball for you guys. I'm giving the game ball to the fans. And the funny part of the story was on the drive there, he told his son was in the car with him. He told him, you know, his son wanted to go in and video whatever his dad was going to say. And he says, no, nah, don't do that. I don't want to draw attention to it. Well, of course, when the coach of the Cincinnati Bengals walks into your bar, every person in the bar grabs their phone and starts recording.
Of course.
So the guy he said in the story, he goes, I don't know what I was thinking.
Yeah.
So, of course, the video has gone viral. But I think it was a nice touch. Sam Weich actually did something very similar back in the day. That's like we're talking like back in the Kenny Anderson days for the Bengals. That's how long it's been, and the Boomer Esiason days. But that was the last time the Bengals won a playoff game. It was a long time ago. That was an exciting, turned into an exciting game. Buccaneers-Eagles was the very opposite of an exciting game. The Buccaneers went up 31-0. And then the Eagles scored 15 points in the fourth quarter. Basically, the Buccaneers didn't need to play defense anymore. It was just,
yeah,
you know, make sure the clock keeps running and make sure you don't get hurt. And that's basically what it was. So, fine. Let the Eagles score two touchdowns in the fourth quarter. Doesn't matter. 31-0, 31-15. A win is a win. Survive in advance. That's what the playoffs are all about. And tonight we have the Los Angeles Rams hosting or playing host to the Arizona Cardinals. Now, brother, I do want to point out, I am 5-for-5 this weekend.
Did you? Who'd you do?
Every team I picked.
Did you tell me?
Every team I picked.
Was this a pick in your head? And then
no.
You, when they won,
it's on Facebook. I can show you.
Okay.
My team, Wrath. We won our playoff matchup.
Right.
And I am one pick away from a perfect week, which will happen if the Rams beat the Cardinals tonight. So we'll see. We'll see what happens there. I took the Rams. The team split this season, but each team won on the road. This game is in Los Angeles. So we'll see. We'll see what happens. Do with that information what you wish out there, all the listeners. Just quickly to point out, for the next round, Saturday games will be Cincinnati at Tennessee. Tennessee is the top seed in the AFC. And San Francisco at Green Bay. That's another moronic decision by the NFL. First of all, let's play the night game in Buffalo when it's going to be 7 degrees at kickoff, and it quickly went to 6.
Mm.
With the wind chill was like 6 or 7 below. So, San Francisco at Green Bay. That's going to be fun. And then on Sunday is the winner of the Rams-Cardinals game at Tampa Bay. And then Buffalo at Kansas City. Buffalo, Kansas City, that should be the AFC Championship. I'm sorry. I'm not sold on Tennessee. And I think Buffalo is a better team than Cincinnati. But that's going to be a great game to watch, or should be a great game to watch. So we'll see. We'll see where it goes. And I don't know. Maybe we'll make some predictions next week.
You get the impression of Buffalo's going to the Super Bowl.
Kansas City's looking good. I'll tell you what. That's going to be a gunslinger game.
Yeah.
You know what? Bet the over on that game, whatever the number is, because that game is going to be 80 points in that game. I have no doubt about that.
They're just going to be
chucking it all over the field,
which is what you want.
Yeah, absolutely.
In a playoff game, you want the chucking. Okay, let's continue with NFL news. Something I predicted last week, brother. You doubted me. If I remember,
I never did hear the video on this, brother.
I said that Joe Judge was going to get fired, and you said, "Well, they're going to stick him. You know, he has one more season. They don't want to pay him." And
my prediction was that they would let the new GM handle the decision.
Right. Yes.
And clearly, the Giants were not happy with. I mean, John Mara denied it, and I don't care what he says because he's lying. He said the last couple of weeks weren't the tipping point for Joe Judge. The 11-minute rant, the team looking thoroughly inept, the quarterback sneak from inside the 5-yard line twice because they were afraid to hand the ball off. I mean, there was total incompetence on the field, and there were also reports that were saying that the Joe Judge had lost the locker room. And if a coach of a losing team loses the locker room, and the players are like, "Look, this guy, he's not the guy. We're not going to listen to this guy," then you need to make a change. But like I said, I thought because they owed him money, because they were also coming in with a new GM, which they're doing interviews. They have done a lot of interviews already, and they still have a few more to do. But the Giants desperately need to get this GM pick right. And I don't know how that's going to happen. I don't know who the final decision maker is going to be, but they need to get all the help that they can get on who to pick and who the guy is, because I don't trust the Giants making these decisions anymore. They just keep picking the wrong people. And until they get the GM right, nothing is going to change. And if you remember, when George Young was brought in to be the general manager of the Giants, that was the NFL's doing. That wasn't the Giants' doing.
Right, right.
So that's why and the Maras, they love to promote from within and this whole Giants culture nonsense. Your team is so screwed up right now. John Mara actually said at the press conference he's more embarrassed of the franchise now than he ever has been. That is a hell of a thing for an owner to say out loud at a press conference.
Yeah, but I think he's just saying that. You don't say it.
It's not something you just
say. There have been worse Giants teams than this.
Maybe so, but you can't. I mean, you don't say it. You never say it. But he said it. That is damning. And let's face it, he is the one who put them there. You can blame GMs, you can blame coaches, you can blame everybody. The owner is the guy hiring all these people.
Right.
So it's Mara and it's Tisch. And it's the two of them, and they need to get it right. Because what the Giants franchise is right now is such a colossal mess. And it's 3 or 4 years away from fixing. They need a real quarterback. They need a coach who can actually build something. They need a general manager who isn't going to whiff on first-round draft picks. The last two GMs, I was watching Eli Apple play last night and was reminded about what a garbage corner he is. And he was a first-round pick for the Giants. And it was 2 years in a row, Eric Flowers and Eli Apple, two guys who had zero impact on the Giants.
Right.
And now we're in the Daniel Jones era. Saquon Barkley at this point is having zero impact. So, that's in the last 10 years, that's at least 4 or 5 draft picks, number one picks, that have done nothing or almost nothing. I hope Saquon Barkley can recapture what he had in his rookie year. I'm not convinced that he will. But until you address the offensive line and turn it into something that can block and can protect Jones and do something, because they're both going to be back next year. Saquon is going to be back and Daniel Jones is going to be back. Until you get an offensive line that can open some holes and make some things happen, then it's going to be 4-13, 5-12. It's going to be another top 10 pick.
Saquon and Daniel should maybe get together way before training camp.
They do.
Start hanging out in April.
It doesn't matter.
Yes, it does.
Daniel Jones is just—he's not very good. That's the problem. Is the Gettleman way overreached for Daniel Jones? And that was a draft class that didn't have a quarterback.
Still, if you use what you got and you say, okay, guys, start hanging out. Let's learn each other.
But they know each other.
They
right?
don't.
They
Obviously,
do.
They don't because of they're crappy the way they are. They don't know each other.
It's about talent. That's the problem. You could spend all year together. You can make them live in the same house. Well, it's not going to make a difference.
It helps.
You need talent, and the offense. There's enough talent on the offense that the offense should have been better. That's the other thing they need to hire. But a great head coach would be a start. But you need an offensive coordinator who can make things happen. The Giants with all the receiving weapons that the Giants have, the Giants, and I've been saying this for a couple of years, the Giants need to go true West Coast offense, and they need to throw 40 times a game at least. And I'm not saying you got to go downfield all the time. Throw those little 6-yard dinks and. Brady's been doing it for 20-something years.
That's what he does.
All he did yesterday, they said it was the quickest release for a quarterback on average. It was 2.1 seconds from snap to release, 2.1.
That's pretty good.
That's why he doesn't get touched. And every pass he throws, 5 yards, 8 yards, it's all they do is march down the field. I don't understand why other NFL teams aren't doing this. How is it that Tom Brady is the only quarterback who's capable of doing this offense?
Because Tom Brady was created by God to be the greatest quarterback in the world.
So dumb. In a league where everybody copies each other, why is there no offensive coordinator who's saying, let's run what the Patriots used to run. Let's run what the Bucs run now. Just watch the film. It's not hard.
I think, brother, you're missing a point about the genius of Gronk.
No.
You know, why has it happened? Why has this happened when Gronk is...
Reason, there's a reason his nickname is America's Idiot.
But Gronk is, you know... Look, Gronk is with Brady. That must mean something, brother. The genius
of Brady
Gronk.
I'll tell you what, Brady got Gronk $1 million last week.
We actually didn't mention it on this show. We mentioned it on the Nassau mix of all places. But yeah, Gronk...
Brady, the coaches were yelling at Brady. Brady's like, no, I'm getting my boy his bonuses.
He got $1 million bonus, $500,000 bonuses for getting a certain 50, amount.
55 catches, 750 yards.
Yep, so.
And Brady didn't come out of the game until Gronk got both of them.
And he could have gotten another I think $1 million too, but he was too far away from it. So
you can't throw the ball to him every play.
Well, you could if you really
not
wanted.
A game that doesn't mean anything. Well. You don't want to get the guy hurt for the playoffs.
Anyway, so he made $1 million because he is friends with Tom Brady.
Made $1 million because Tom Brady is his boy.
That says a lot.
And he didn't invite him out to dinner because he said something like, oh, you know, Tom's got that weird diet.
Well, that's part of his deal.
Who doesn't eat steak? Except for vegetarians. I don't think Brady's a vegetarian.
No, but he does a lot of weird. His diet's very weird. But then again, he's still playing.
Just
so
get your boy a steak. That's all.
I think he probably would.
Or get him a lobster or something.
But yeah,
something
but
nice.
You know, I don't know the deal with that. But you know, Brady does eat weird.
Well,
we know that.
Anyway, Joe Judge, 10-23 in two seasons.
Yeah,
he was 6-10 last year and 4-13 this year. So and you know, I was a proponent of his, and people, regular listeners of the show, know that I was in Joe Judge's corner.
You were.
But I turned, the 11-minute rant turned me. Because
really?
That was, that to me was like, what is he doing?
He sounds crazy. I don't mind the rant because sometimes you have to get it out of your system.
You don't do it in front of the media.
Well.
Do it, that's what your coaching staff is for. That's what your wife is for.
Yeah, but then it gets leaked. Well, your wife's not going
to
leak it.
You don't air it out to the media.
But the coaching staff's going to go to, you know, the Giants beat reporter. Oh, my God. He just went crazy on us.
I don't even know how many of the coaches were actually speaking to the media. But even so, assistant coaches aren't going to do that because if the head coach gets fired, they lose their jobs. Why are they going to rat out the head coach?
They don't like him. He lost the room.
He's their guy. He's the one who gave them jobs. They like him. NFL assistant coaches, they're all friends or friendly with the head guy. That's how they get. That's how everybody gets jobs in the NFL. It's all a big tree.
We first of all, the Giants need the general manager, who will then pick the head coach. So nothing's going to happen really for like another.
No,
two
they're doing interviews for the GM. I wouldn't be surprised if a GM was hired either this week or next week. I mean, it's going to happen fairly quickly.
Yeah, but they're not going to have a coach until after the Super Bowl.
No, the coach is going to take longer. I wouldn't be surprised though if the Giants have a GM by the end of the month, because they got to move pretty quick. Because I mean, stuff is happening in the off season, and you know, the draft happens not very long after the Super Bowl. You need to have people in place, and you need to have opinions, and you know what kind of coach are you going to hire? What does he like to do? And that's going to impact your draft. I mean, I still think that either the Jets or the Giants should draft that kid out of Alabama, Evan Neal, the offensive lineman. Somebody from New York needs to draft that kid. He's a monster. But they need both the Jets and Giants need O-line. But I mean, the Giants desperately need O-line.
That's right. We're going to take a break right now. You're listening to 90.3 WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College. From the press box on your radio or your listening device, give us a call, 516-572-7440.
All hit music. For all those songs radio has forgotten about, join me, Big Ed, Mondays from 10 a.m. till noon for the Good Gold Show. We'll bring back all the great hits of the 50s, 60s, 70s, and more. The sounds of doo-wop to disco, all the Motown, soul, and great rock and roll. We'll even take your requests and dedications to the Good Gold Show.
Music.
On the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC, and streaming on the iHeartRadio app.
Okay. Yo.
Tell your friends about the Nassau Morning Madhouse. Hear what you're missing.
Check it out. Joining us in the studio, we got Kevin, the hippopotamus. Kevin, how you doing?
I'm doing good.
Nice to meet you, Kevin.
What?
I didn't see you come in.
Hey, you know, I'm a hippopotamus.
I didn't know.
See, that's
Kevin.
The improv. The improv of radio is so great.
You know what's even better than Kevin?
What?
His nephew.
Is he here in the studio now?
Come in, Gerald. Hello, what's up, pals?
Whoa, Gerald, man.
Hello, what's up, guys?
You look nothing alike.
No, that's because I'm a squirrel.
Oh.
Yeah, I was adopted.
Oh, you're adopted.
Yes.
As a squirrel, what do you look for throughout your day?
I look for nuts. Mostly nuts all day.
Now, how does it work?
I like just eating nuts, putting them in my mouth. You know, that's what we do.
NASA Morning Madhouse. Weekday mornings from 7 to 9. Yeah. On the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
Shake off the realities of the day, broaden your musical horizons, and embrace the diversity every Monday afternoon at 5 for 2 hours of Revelations. The show offers a potently unique collection of music with an emphasis on themes and rock rarities. An occasional tour de force of blues and soul mixed with compelling sets of folk and folk rock. I'm Steve Kay, and I've got the perfect soundtrack for your drive home every Monday afternoon at 5. On Revelations, right here on the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.
The voice of Nassau Community College, voted best radio station by Best of Long Island. And we thank everyone for contributing to our victory. There will be a parade down by the Nassau Coliseum, working on the details. Actually, we're not, but would be nice.
We need to get Dennis Potman there.
Yeah, but he's down in Florida.
Yeah. Invite him up.
Yeah, that'd be good. We could get Trottier. Trottier doesn't live, but Gillies lives in the area. Nystrom lives in the area.
Nystrom would be good to get, too.
Nystrom is... I don't know anyone who hates Bobby Nystrom. Islander fans.
Oh, there's a love for Bobby Nystrom. What are you kidding me?
He scored
the goal.
He scored a lot of, actually, playoff goals. If you look at his history, his playoff goals are incredible.
I only care about one of them.
That's the only one that's...
And it was a trash goal. It really was. It was just a deflection. He didn't do anything. It's just deflection.
But it just shows that where you put the stick is much more important than, you know, this big slap shot or whatever.
Long Island partied for a week.
That's right. Anyway, speaking of the Islanders, by the way, I'm Rob Leonard. He's Tim Leonard. 516-572-7440. Sadly for the Islanders, brother, COVID keeps coming up with the Islanders. A lot of people are sick. Barry Trotz is out with COVID.
No, I mean, they're pretty much healthy at this point. Yeah, Barry Trotz, but it just seems like one giant COVID. They all had it a month or so ago, and now they're pretty much done with that part of it. So it's actually, I don't want to say it's to their advantage per se, but, you know, I mean, they just got back from basically 2 weeks off because Canada's restrictions forced games to be postponed. They had 4 games postponed. They came back. They played the Devils, won that game 3-2, and then on Saturday, they lost to the Capitals 2-0, which, you know, it was a tough game. Some goalie I never heard of made 23 saves, but 23 saves. I mean, when you only put 23 shots on goal, you're not having a really good game. Capitals got an early goal, and Ovechkin scored an empty netter, which 755 goals in his career. That's ridiculous. But then Semyon Varlamov made 34 saves, only his fifth start since mid-November. That game against the Rangers when he let in 4 goals and looked awful, only 5 starts since then. So, you know, Sorokin has been the guy, but, you know, the Islanders, they need wins. They got plenty of games in hand. Who knows when all of these games are actually going to get played, but they need to win 6, 7, 8 in a row, or at least get eight or nine out of ten, because they're buried in last place right now.
Well, I'm looking at the thing right now. The Islanders have played 30 games total. They're 11-13-6. Okay, that's not great, but it's not.
No, they need to get significantly above 500.
I hate to say this, but who's the number one team in the NHL?
The Rangers.
In the Metropolitan Division, at least.
The Rangers are one of the best teams in the league. We probably should start talking about them a little bit.
I guess. And they've played 39 games.
I know we ignore them on the show, and it comes at the consternation of Ranger fans, but I'm sorry. I just don't care about the Rangers. But we're probably going to have to start talking about them soon because they are becoming a force in the NHL.
They are.
They are the best team in the Metropolitan Division. And, you know, I don't know, maybe we'll talk about them a little bit next week or something. They did have a couple All-Stars. Adam Pellick, defenseman, is named to his first All-Star team this weekend. Also, I do want to tell the listeners that you only have a little bit, like another day or two, to vote for Matthew Barzal, who is one of the many players eligible in the online vote for the last player in each division. First of all, vote for Matthew Barzal at NHL.com, but also don't vote for John Tavares. So your vote could make sure that John Tavares doesn't get into the NHL All-Star game. And if you're wondering, yes, I do carry grudges. I don't want John Tavares at the All-Star game.
No, I don't either. And
make that happen. Everybody that voted for us for Best on Long Island, vote for Matthew Barzal and vote against John Tavares. Make it happen.
Yeah, Tavares is down at the bottom here in the Atlantic Division.
Yeah.
Barzal's, let's see, how do I do this now? Oh, I have to give. I have to sign in.
Yeah, you do your email, and you know, they're looking for they want to put you on their mailing list.
But you can vote ten times a day. I have to set up a.
That's fine. Do it after the show, brother. Not during the show. It's not something you do during the show. Yeah. Lane Lambert, because as you said, Barry Trotz is in COVID protocol right now. Lane Lambert, the assistant coach, was behind the Islanders bench on Saturday. And probably will be tonight as well. The Islanders playing the Flyers tonight. I tell you what, I saw the game against the Devils. The Islanders look good. For a team that hadn't played in 2 weeks, they look good. They're starting to get back, to playing Islanders hockey. The 3-2 win, that's Islanders hockey right there in a nutshell. Really, yeah. I mean, 3-1 is probably more Islanders hockey, but, you know, that's the only bad thing about the Devils game. Was Ross Johnston wound up getting suspended for 3 games for a check to the head.
Ouch.
On Devils forward A.J. Greer early in the first period. So 3-game suspension is going to cost him $15,000. First game against Capitals, he's got 2 more to go. Johnston has 2 assists in 9 games this season. So, everybody who follows the Islanders know what his role is, and his role is to hit people. Just, you know, hopefully you keep it legal. Again, it's like we've been saying since the early part of the season is the Islanders just need to put a streak together. They need to put a long winning streak together. You're going to lose games here and there. It's going to happen. It's very difficult in the NHL to win 8 or 9 or 10 in a row. But the Islanders need at least, like, small streaks. They need 3 or 4 or 5 before, and like instead of a loss, maybe like an overtime loss or a shootout loss, so they still get a point. But they need every single point they can get at this point, because there's, you know, I mean, we're halfway through the season or close to it, and they like I said, they're buried. They're so far behind, and a big part of that is because they played a lot fewer games than everybody in the division. But even if you extrapolate and say, all right, well, they still have to play another 5 or 6 games, so that's fine. Add 10 points. They're still at the bottom of the division. So that is the problem. It's going to take a very long and sustained period of winning for the Islanders to get themselves back into the race and to try to get a top 4 spot to get into the playoffs. Because right now, if you look at what's going on, it's not happening. And then what? I mean, that becomes the thing. Does Lou Lamoriello just kind of throw the season away as an outlier, or does he say after the season, hey, we need to make changes, and we need I don't think he's going to say we need to blow it up, because the Islanders are still a fairly young team.
Well, they haven't. I'm looking at the schedule right now. Maybe they haven't updated it, but the time that they took out for the Olympics still hasn't been filled in. So
they're going to definitely make up games in that window.
They said they were, but they haven't posted them yet.
Because they don't know. They don't know what they're doing yet. No. I mean, it's all going to depend on what's going on with Omicron and when Canada goes back, you know, comes back off of their restrictions.
Yeah, we should say Canada is much stiffer about this than we are.
Well, I mean, they reduced their capacity to 50%.
Right, right.
And the NHL doesn't want to play games with 50% capacity because you're losing money.
That's what it's all about. By the way, it's interesting. Today is Martin Luther King Day, and usually they have an afternoon game.
For the NBA.
Yeah. The NBA. It's not for the NHL?
Yeah, not usually.
Oh, okay. Because the Islanders are playing tonight, Philly, at UBS.
At UBS, yes.
And we should say we've yet to go to a game. We should.
We need to work on that.
We have to. Maybe in March. March would probably be the best time to go. Let's see. Let me check. Let's see. Actually, most of the rest of the month here is home games.
Yes. So let's look at the schedule and plan our ticket purchases after the show.
Well, we have to get our friend Bob Tuck to come with us too.
Oh well, yeah, after the show.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm just saying. Anyway, so let's go Islanders. We you know, as much as the Rangers. Let's be honest, Ranger fans. We're gonna say that they're playing great. So
they are.
You know,
No denying it.
They're in first place right now. So
the new coach Gerard Gallant has done a nice job. The young players are coming of age, and the Rangers looking good.
Yeah, it is. Okay, let's talk about the Nets because I don't know, brother. This is such a weird team. You know, this team should be like really being like the team everyone in the NBA is talking about, and that they are talking about, but for a lot of wrong reasons.
A lot of wrong reasons.
Kyrie Irving is one of them. You know, they play well, but they're in first, and they've been doing well, or have been in first. Yeah, they're all over the place.
They were a very talented team, first of all. Let's not.
But after last year, everyone said, "Oh, this is going to be the team," and it hasn't been the way it should.
Well, because Kyrie hasn't been playing, and you know now we're looking at a situation with the Brooklyn Nets where 11 of their next 14 games are on the road. And everybody thought, all right, hey, we're finally going to get to see the Nets big three together and playing because obviously Kyrie Irving can only play on the road because he's not vaccinated. And
right.
I still don't understand why he won't get vaccinated, but whatever. I'm not going to bother talking about it anymore because nothing has changed in several months since we've been talking about it. But Kevin Durant the other night winds up spraining his MCL. One of his teammates was knocked over and rolled into his leg and his knee got hyperextended.
I saw the clip, man. Oh.
It's a tough injury. It hurts because I mean it's a little tear in the back of your knee. That's where the MCL is in the back of your knee. But the word is that Durant and who was the Nets' leading scorer, let's not forget that, is going to be out 4 to 6 weeks with the injury. So just like last year. Everybody was eager to see after Harden got traded to the Nets. Everybody was eager to see the big three. Let's see the big three. Let's see how they work together. Injuries. If it wasn't one guy, it was the other guy. And Harden got hurt, then Kyrie got hurt, then Durant got hurt.
Yep.
And it was always somebody getting hurt, and they really weren't able to play very many games together. And so here we were for this season, about to go into the stretch. Like I said, 11-14 on the road. So Kyrie's going to play a bunch.
Yep.
Well, now Durant's not going to play. He's not going to be available pretty much for any of those games. 4 to 6 weeks. I mean, if he comes back in 4 weeks, that's a month. Well, you know, hey, 13 games, that's pretty much a month. So here we are, and it's a difficult situation because, Kyrie obviously is not going to play home games, which means James Harden, for those home games, is going to have to do a lot of heavy lifting. It's going to be all on him. You know, yes, he has help from Blake Griffin. Yes, he has help from LaMarcus Aldridge. But Harden's going to be the guy.
When's the pill version of this coming out, the COVID shot?
A few months.
Because that would be a way to do it. You're sneaking in his milk in the morning. And
I don't know what he wants, you know, or if he'd be willing to do that. I mean, I haven't heard him say anything about it. And I don't know that enough is known about it yet to figure out what that situation is going to be. I don't understand. If somebody's willing to take a pill but not willing to get vaccinated, that doesn't make any sense to me. I don't want to talk about COVID and whatever. It's infuriating. But we're going to see. I was going to say we're going to see where the Nets are, but we're not going to see where the Nets are because the Nets without Kevin Durant aren't the Nets. So basically, for these next 14 games, the Nets are going to be kind of treading water. And yeah. I'm sure they'll win games because they still have plenty of talent, and they should win games. Although, you know, recently, a couple weeks ago, they lost three in a row at home, and they really have been puzzling at home. It doesn't make sense.
Puzzling's
to me.
A good word, brother.
Because this is a team that should dominate.
I know that
they should win every home game they play, or just about. For them to lose three in a row at home is absurd. It just doesn't make any sense, and that's all about effort. And Durant called his teammates out after one of those losses and said, "We're not getting it done. Like, we need to do this ourselves." And then they lost the next game.
By the way, I was wrong. The Nets are a half game behind Chicago.
Right, and that was, I tell you what, that was a big win for them, and that was one of the games that Kyrie played.
They're in second place.
They blew Chicago out of the water in the third quarter in that game. They were losing, and then by the end of the third quarter, they were up by about 20. It was absurd what they did to the Bulls in the second half of that game. And that is what this team is capable of doing. That's how good this team is capable of being. And we just don't see it because of the injuries and because Kyrie doesn't want to play, getting vaccinated. But this team could be something very, very special.
I know, they're not.
But we never see it. We never see it for any kind of prolonged period of time. But that game against the Bulls, wow, unbelievable how good they were that night. Just absurd how good they were that night. And I'm not going to say that they can play like that every day, because no team can play like that every game, but unbelievable. I mean, and that's the Bulls are a good team, a very good team. And that's what this Nets team is capable of doing.
No, I agree.
I mean, I still think the champion, the NBA champion, I still think it's coming out of the West. I think it's going to be the Suns or the Warriors.
Right.
But the Nets certainly are good enough and should be the team out of the East.
And we should say, brother, that the Knicks are right now 10th place in the Eastern Conference, 22-21, which isn't bad, but I thought they'd be a little bit better by now. But they're within, like, three teams to get to the number 7 position. Charlotte, yeah. Charlotte's 23-20.
There's a whole bunch.
So there's
but that
Charlotte,
seven,
Toronto.
Say, you need to get to 6. Bro.
Yeah.
You can't. 7 through 10 is that play-in game. It's literally one game for your playoff life.
But you know, at least you're in. But, you know, right now Cleveland's at number 6 at 26-18. Before we go, brother, I want to talk. We don't do a lot of tennis on this show. We usually do it after the U.S. Open when we call Dan DeRosalia in.
Tennis expert.
Tennis expert, Dan DeRosalia. But this is an interesting one because Novak Djokovic was caught lying about a couple of things, among other things, about having
more than a couple of things,
a COVID shot or test or whatever. And, of course, he's now not playing in the Australian Open. There's a good chance he might not even play in the French Open because of what's going on with COVID, and Australia is very serious about it over there, especially when you come from, you know, outside the country, you're coming in.
Correct.
There's a lot of things going on over there, and I thought, you know, we talk about before the end of the show. We got about 6 minutes.
Yes, and there's one other topic I want to discuss before we go.
What's up?
But we'll get to it.
Okay.
But yeah, Djokovic's visa was initially canceled on January 6th. Because the border official decided he didn't qualify for a medical exemption. And then Djokovic claimed that his people filled out the wrong form or filled out the form wrong.
Right.
Or it's just, I mean, first of all, it just seems like we've been talking about this for weeks already. It feels already to me, in the Australian Open literally started less than 24 hours ago. And it feels like it should be over already because we've been talking about the Australian Open for weeks. But Djokovic won an appeal to stay for the tournament. And let me just a little more background. The medical exemption for Australia's rules for unvaccinated visitors, he said Djokovic was exempted from the tournament's vaccine rules because he had been infected with the COVID-19 virus within the previous 6 months. So he first won his appeal to stay for the tournament. But Australia's immigration minister later revoked his visa. Then three federal court judges decided unanimously on Sunday to affirm the immigration minister's right to cancel Djokovic's visa. All of that that I just read is from ESPN.com. The one thing that Australians, first of all, they're taking COVID very seriously. And a lot of Australians were pretty angry that Djokovic was trying to kind of weasel his way into the country.
Yeah, sneak in.
Yeah, and didn't want to follow the laws, and I shouldn't say laws, but the rules that every Australian has been following for almost 2 years now.
Right.
And they have I don't want to say they've managed it, but they've done pretty well. They've done better than most countries as far as COVID and the spread and everything else. So that was part of the backlash that was going on here. But now, from what I saw last night, Djokovic is going to be banned from Australia for 3 years.
Wow.
So never mind this year's Australian Open, but next year's as well and the one after that.
Right.
So that's damaging for him, because this is a guy who wants to win a Grand Slam, and it's something that obviously if he doesn't play the Australian Open, he's not going to be able to win a Grand Slam. So, you know, this is where we are. Djokovic, as far as I know or as far as I read, was on a flight to Dubai and then was going to fly back to Serbia. The Serbian president had some incredibly insulting things to say about the Australians.
Of course.
And it sounded like a lunatic with the conspiracy theories. I'm not even going to bother with him. But that, you know, that's where we are with the Australian Open. And according to the ATP, more than 95% of the top 100 men and women's players in the tour are vaccinated. So, you know, I get Djokovic and you know, he doesn't want to put something in his body that he's not sure what it is, but there's ample evidence that shows that vaccines are safe.
Right, so, and if he really wants to win the U.S. Open, which to his career and his image would be a fantastic thing, then you know what? Get the shots.
You said U.S. Open. Did you mean Australia?
Did I say U.S.? Yeah. I meant Australia.
Okay, I just
want
to make sure. I just want to clarify,
So, but, you know, just do it. Just say, okay, you know what? If it means that much, do it. You know, because now he's banned for, we'll be banned for 3 years. So.
3 years.
So that's not good.
But right, hey. The last thing I wanted to talk about.
Quickly.
Well, this weekend, the Premier League made one of the worst decisions that I have ever seen in sports.
You sure about that?
They postponed the Tottenham-Arsenal match. And the reason the Premier League put rules in place because of COVID, and they wanted to be able to postpone matches if rampant cases of COVID swept through a team and they didn't have enough players. So that was the reason that this rule was created. Well, here's the issue. Arsenal has one player who has COVID.
One.
They have four players who are playing at the African Cup of Nations, so they won't be around for at least a couple more weeks. They have three players who are injured, and that's fine, because right now Tottenham has one player with COVID and also has three players injured, so it's the same. Arsenal, last week, loaned out two players. They sent them to other clubs to play so they could get playing time. And one of their players, who's an idiot, Granit Xhaka, was red carded from the game, so he was suspended for this match. Tell me how any of this is Tottenham's fault. But the game gets suspended for quote unquote COVID reasons. One player. All right? Wolves played a match this week.
Right.
On, I believe it was Saturday. Saturday or Sunday. They had a 15-year-old on the bench. Because they had real COVID cases, but the Premier League said, no, you have to play. So the fact that Arsenal protested and wanted this game not played is because they're mismanaged. Because the African Cup of Nations is going to happen. They knew this. They just didn't want to play Tottenham without their stars. And the Premier League allowed it, which is horrible.
You're saying the Arsenal team has powers that they shouldn't have over the Premier League?
I'm saying the Premier League is a bunch of idiots. This never should have been postponed.
Okay.
Never.
Okay.
Horrible decision.
Horrible decision. Who's worse, the Premier League or Roger Goodell?
Right now, the Premier League. That's how bad it is.
Anyway, you've been listening to 90.3 WHPC from the press box. That's what we do every Monday, 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. I'm Rob Leonard. He is Tim Leonard. This show becomes a podcast later on, wherever you get podcasts. And we have to read one more thing, brother, because that's the way it is. Don't forget about Play It Cool every Thursday at 7 p.m., an hour dedicated to the latest and greatest hip-hop and R&B music, mostly recent and popular songs. But, hey, we also showcase timeless classics. That's Play It Cool every Thursday at 7 p.m. right here at 90.3 WHPC. Coming up next at 10 o'clock, he's Big Ed. And you know what that means. Some great music will be played in the next 2 hours. The Good Gold Show is coming up next. Take care, and we'll see you next time. I'll see you Friday with Beatles songs. Take care, and bye-bye.